notice that the altar today is shaped in a beautiful earth mandala. And the two white candles and the quartz crystal are surrounded by beautiful formations of various earth beings. Notice what this mandala looks like. We also see that there are many other people sitting around this altar now. There are 17 people sitting in a circle around this altar, and that there is a man sitting beneath the tree with his eyes closed, meditating at its roots. This man has a medicine pouch decorated with special symbols and colors woven in intricate design. And within this medicine bag holds seeds of wisdom and many treasures from his journeys. As you rest at the altar and get comfortable beneath the tree, he opens his eyes and he begins to speak. And so with this, we will open our awareness for our special guest, Dandelion.
Welcome. So, thank you all for being part of this council, and thank you for such a wonderfully developed inner vision that we can share in together. It's very important to access what we may have been called in our culture as the imagination. But what I've come to realize, and I'm sure you all are seeing in many ways, that there is a level where the imagination is connected, where telepathy is accessible. And this is something we're reclaiming even in this visualization. So the fact that we can see together in this inner space, in this inner council, is a really important facet of our awareness of human consciousness, of human capacity, that we're here essentially to reclaim together. So I really appreciate you all being interested to experiment in this way. And I see that this will continue to grow, and as we develop our awareness towards less physical, tangible aspects of our being, that this will actually become a great teaching tool, and already is. So I appreciate all of you for joining in to give the opportunity to sit under this sacred tree and discuss these aspects. In my journey, for those of you who don't know, I developed an ability and a desire to work with plants, and specifically weeds, the plants that may have been forgotten, because I had an inner vision and inkling that these plants are just as sentient and conscious as any of the more loud-speaking teacher plants, such as the mushrooms or ayahuasca or anything like this. That indeed all plants are sentient and all plants are alive. And what I've tried my best to do is lay a path for myself, because in looking to east and west, there is a very thin thread of plant mysticism that exists, and yet it hasn't been a laid out path like it has for maybe the yoga teachings or Tibetan Buddhism or any of this, but essentially it's almost as if it's the naked shamanic path, which manifests from within ourselves as we do our own work to clear ourselves, to know what is the mind versus what is the instinct. And so that's something I definitely like to remind everyone today, is that we have a tremendous capacity as human beings to tap deeply into our instincts. The reason why I found plants to be incredible teachers of developing instincts is that they will never cajole their answers, and a mushroom who is poisonous will be poisonous to all beings democratically, unanimously. So we have a great level of physical teacher who is completely honest. I really appreciate that from the plant world. So we can really literally reach out with our psychic capacity and feel what is this plant? What is this plant worth? What are the chemistries behind this plant? And yet we have the ability to verify that. And I find that to be very important because, you know, maybe your instinct needs developing, and all of ours needs developing, not something we've cultivated in the same way that we've cultivated the mental functioning. So what I'd like to really discuss today is some steps that we can all take if we're interested in developing sort of deep ecology practices or conscious awareness practices towards how to symbiotize with what I would call something like the Gaian consciousness or the Gaian source or the living dream world or the aspect behind all of us that is indeed connected and full of guidance and information. So, you know, this really brings a quest for us of activism, and this has always been a really important function for me in seeking how to understand how we can really be truly helpful activists. And I know that you all who are listening are also in this path of inquiry of how can I generate this passion that I feel into a way that really is effective. And so if you resonate with anywhere that I've been, which has literally been to try to get people to wake up, maybe for the last 3 to 5 years, just kind of flailing my arms and saying, you guys, truth is more important than belief systems, essentially. And yet, I have noticed that it hasn't worked as effectively as I'd hoped. And sometimes, through our aggressive activist tendencies, we can actually turn people off. And so, really, the question for accessing change of people's karma takes a lot of subtle awareness, because we might close people down and therefore make their path even harder. So what can we do about that, and how can we resolve that? So when we look to ecology, when we look to nature, when we look to grass, we can literally see these as our allies in helping to awaken people. I forget who said to see eternity in a blade of grass, right? And this literally is a helping force, a spiritual force, an ally, and all the plants are the allies towards this practice of helping others awaken. And when we choose to symbiotize with the plant consciousness of the world or the crystal consciousness of the world, we can actually get guidance that's got much better ideas than we could conceive of sometimes. And I find that with the ability to work ecology in this way, there's a lot less churning off of people, because truthfully every single person interacts with nature. I mean, even if there's someone who lives inside of an apartment building who goes to work and comes home in a car, they may cross a little patch of green, they may cross a tree, they may see a bird fly past them. And of course, we're learning to realize, again, that this is like a dream, and that every single symbol, every single natural aspect that we come into contact with somehow has this sort of metaphoric value to it. Every animal means something, and it's relevant towards what we think or what we're doing. And so as we wake this symbolic process up again in consciousness, we then have the ability to help others realize and deepen the mystery. So, you know, we have these physical aspects of this practice, right? So I kind of call it the yoga of ecology or the yoga of nature or something where the best of the yogic principles that we understand can be applied towards ecology, nature, and nature connection. So, you know, one of the practices may look like picking up garbage. So I know that Dave Miller, if you're listening, you mentioned at some point, you know, the awareness of picking up the bubblegum wrapper and to not drop it on the ground. And all these practices, which I may call something like physical manifestations of ecological awareness. Now, what I know in my own practice is that I can observe my intent and energy while picking up that person's cigarette butt, and sometimes I realize that there's a bit of spite within myself. If I'm acting my activism out of spite, then am I really helping that person to transform, or am I judging them, and therefore causing probably a likeliness that when I'm not looking at that person, they'll do it again out of rebellion. So we're literally creating and actually keeping alive this dichotomy of repression versus rebellion when our activism is anti, right? Anti this, anti that, anti fracking, anti all of this stuff. And although that is very important, and signing petitions and really being ecologically active, I would like to suggest that we have that level covered, and we're doing pretty well with that. However, I would like to invite the possibility to observe what is causing us to motivate ourselves to have that interaction. And when I've looked at my own self for that, I've realized that a tremendous level of work can be done on myself by observing how I react to those circumstances. And this I would call more like the energetic depth of the yoga practice. And this is really akin to maybe hatha yoga being the postures of yoga, the asana, the physical movement. But that also can become like rote. That also can just become physical movement without mindfulness. But what yoga really is the cessation of the fluctuation of anything but the intent that I'm trying to put there. So can I manifest genuine care and love in front of the person whose garbage I'm picking up? Or do I give them a psychic dart, essentially? And this is a very important practice, because if we can truly manifest nothing but caring, loving choices, then essentially we would be able to manifest the behavioral pattern that we wish to come into the world. And literally, we're backed into the corner, friends, which means that whoever can hold the energy and manifest the energy through their own behavior, that will transcend everything. And this is literally the choice. We're getting out of the word game. We're getting out of the philosophical debate level. That was very important for the last few years. And now what I see is we're merging towards a state of being together where we can actually manifest the principles that we seek to be observing in the world. And that would become so deniable that other people would start to realize that, oh, nothing's happening other than these people are becoming more happy. So that's definitely a call out to all communities. Please, all of you who are listening and will listen to this, be a hub for your environment. You know, as I said, no one can do everything, but everyone can do something. So what are the sort of ethical and ecologically minded practices we can get into? Well, as I mentioned, when we have that reaction to the garbage being thrown on the ground, that's a huge storehouse of understanding all the unsettled energies within our being. And if we begin to target those energies and pay attention to them, we can really transform with ecology, with nature, because essentially everything that's coming into our being is going to give us a feedback mechanism. And so this is where we get into the aspect of reality that we co-create with. And I would recommend that we don't create nature and therefore don't create our reality. We create our culture and we create our way of perceiving nature. And one of the things that I'd like to remind the consciousness is that we are indeed choosing what nature behaves like and therefore using that as a reflection for what we should behave like. And we are birthing out of the Darwinian paradigm of survival of the fittest, where the lion eats the gazelle. And now we're starting to become awakened to the realization that nature has been speaking symbiotic relationships more loudly than it has been seeking a capitalist paradigm, a dominator or totalitarian paradigm. So So we literally are able to leave that old paradigm behind. But the problem lies in the fact that we keep birthing it through our attachment to it, through our recognition of it, instead of just plowing forward in a new way. And this is nothing short of what we need to do. We need to just build another paradigm that's so much more shiny than the old one that it just completely destroys that old way. And we don't need to necessarily oppose it. And I think by opposing it, we actually keep it alive. And that doesn't mean don't be aware of factory farming or don't be aware of hydrofracking or all of these things. But hydrofracking, for example, will not exist once our communities can live without natural gas. So it's only in our purchases and our attention that it's bringing these things to have the power that they do. Essentially, they don't have any power. The power comes from us, and we're driving. And I think this is a huge factor of realizing that those who pretend they're driving the game of reality actually have no point of reference towards the handlebar. And what reality seems to be more like is a co-creative process where the mind gets turned inside out. And we can look at something like the vehicle. Henry Ford was imagining, visualizing this object that could actually fly through space and time. And to his people, that was crazy. And they could not conceive of it. And yet, through his visualization, he was able to actually physically manifest it. This is how reality works. This is the laws of nature. And we have to be very careful because all of the thoughts we have are influencing the co-creation of our experience. And we indeed are tapped into this deeper grid that is not recognized in our society's culture. Whatever we've grown up in does not have the ability to encompass that. But what we need to do is reclaim that and take that as our birthright. We are co-creating. We do have a say in the direction of our species, and this is a profound thing. And so what we really need to do then is to look at some of the core disconnections between our creative capacity, or I'd like to say our co-creative capacity with the ecosystem or Gaia, and kind of the cultural conditioning that we may be operating under. So what I find teaching plant walks is that people generally, some come very afraid to touch the dandelions or the plantain. There is a fear that's built up. And why is that fear exist? Because humans feel separate from nature. And if we continue to create a paradigm of separation from nature, then we will indeed not survive. And we need to resolve this feeling of separation from nature. So what is under the separation from nature is the idea that the ego is somehow separate from nature, and that if we can just kill the ego, we will be nature. But what I would recommend is that the ego is actually a servant. The ego makes a terrible master, but a great servant to nature. And so what I find within my own practice is as I face my ego and try to see that my ego is just normal and natural and it's actually healthy, I can actually resolve that sense of self towards being in service to the ecosystem, to the great change that I know is here. And it's almost like a calculated kung fu to take us to the point where we feel we need to transcend our ego in order to be spiritually enlightened. That's really a fallen from Eden concept. It is kind of the archetype of being banished from Eden. If you don't remember the story of Eden, it goes something like Adam and Eve were in paradise and they were foraging their lives away and enjoying, and then they found the forbidden fruit from the tree of immortality, mind you, and Eve convinced Adam to eat it, and therefore we fell from some great state. what I would recognize and recommend to all of us is that we never actually fell, and that that story has an archetypal motif of hypnosis on our society, and therefore the ego is banished from Eden, and therefore we're creating a self-fulfilled prophecy of a duality between nature and human. And this is the actual brainwashing, the mind brainwashing. And so then we can come to, okay, well, is there garbage? What do we do about garbage? Well, this is a very important question, because we know that to pick up other people's garbage, to pick up other people's plastic wrappers, will not manifest the direct change of resolving the idea that garbage is even a concept. Julia Butterfly Hill, who lived in the redwood forest when they were trying to cut it down in a treehouse for many years, she had stated that there is no such thing as garbage. Garbage is just an idea. And so we have two options. One is to be aggressively against those who produce garbage, and the other one is to try our best to manifest a garbage-free lifestyle. And I would recommend that if we could find ways to start transcending the use of garbage, that could be like a protocol for humanity. And there are some really easy steps. For example, using a stainless steel jar instead of plastic water bottles, right? We're all getting privy to that idea. And so I've been able to save the use of probably 1 million water bottles in the last 5 years going into landfills or being recycled. Now, these are physical manifestations, but the most important aspect of them is that we are doing an inner training where we are becoming aware of cause and effect once again. And this is really the revelation that we're coming into, is the food source or the sustenance source and me are connected. There is a karmic interaction between where everything is coming from, what money I spend to bring it around the world, and where I get everything that I need. And this has to continue to grow and will continue to grow. And so what I'm looking at and what I'm seeking to do is get back into the backyard and to learn how the backyard is that place and everywhere else is a seeking. And we can resolve that seeking. So part of working with plants and part of seeing those plants, as we did in our visualization, is to learn how to interact directly with nature again. And so that dandelion plant in your backyard is literally the ambassador for all of human consciousness, for all of Gaian consciousness. And we can actually tap into that if we take the time and we slow down. And they seem to have really good ideas. And part of the reason that they have such good ideas is because it's actually their planet. It's actually the plant's biosphere. In some ways, we were designed as a way to carry and serve the plants in a way that they couldn't because they were rooted into the ground. But they're the ones that are sequestering the minerals for our bodies to grow, the same magnesium, calcium, phosphorus, potassium. All these great things are churned up from rock that were created during the Big Bang into plants, which we then consume and can receive their nutrients. So this is a very important symbiotic relationship which we're coming into the awareness of. So, you know, try to learn some plants. Obviously, do it safely. Verify everything with field guides and books. Don't necessarily consider, oh, the plant told me, therefore I'll eat it, because the plants might require a new level of humbleness that you may not be used to. So test your intuition with biology, and then the great spirit and the great matter can work in symbiosis, and this is possibly the resolution that we need within ourselves. So if we look at this nature and human dichotomy, and we then realize that even in our spirituality, even in our best spiritual practices, we do have a transcendent concept, which could be akin to something like millennial Christianity saying that we'll transcend the physical plane and go to the fifth dimension, or will leave and go to heaven, any of this stuff. But what I would propose is that that's a matter of dualizing nature and God. And we need to come into a resolution between nature and God. And this is essentially the physical and the spirit. They need to be married together. And this is the great work that we find ourselves in, is can we actually transcend the duality of these two concepts? And this is very much what I would consider is return to nature. Because what these plant teachers seem to show us, the ones that talk with very loud voices, is that you have within you the consciousness of all that ever was. And essentially biology has built a consciousness that we can actually tap into through deeper states of awareness. And the more we tap into these states, the more we become something like a channel and can actually channel the Gaian consciousness into humanity. And this is a very important work, because if we're going to find solutions that humans have never thought of, this is definitely the place to look. The plants know. Gaian consciousness knows the way out of the situation that we're in this planet. So if you haven't had an experience of what I would call nature sort of talking to you, what I would recommend is to try to create that experience. So there are some simple techniques. Maybe it looks like going out in the woods, sitting against a tree with your back against the tree, breathing, allowing yourself to fully breathe in the essence of the forest, and just sit there and still your mind, still your mind, still your mind, and get to a point where you ask. And don't ask for some miracle. Just ask for a small sign. And if that sign shows itself to you, then allow yourself the time to integrate. We don't need a million signs. We need time for integration of those signs. And what I find is, as I unfold my connection with ecology, with nature, that deeper and deeper symbols start to come up. And this is even in the physical world. A bald eagle will suddenly show itself, or a bear will walk by, or a mouse, or a squirrel. And everything there is significant towards an archetypal or embodied metaphoric way towards the question that we're asking. In essence, nature is an oracle, and we can again begin to unlock the oracular nature of nature. And this is a very important practice that perhaps is left out of yogic philosophy, but is very much ingrained in the Native American practices that we're familiar with. So again, if we could bring the Eastern mysticism and the great earth-based spiritual practices of Native American culture and unite them within our being, this perhaps is a very developed shamanic, ecological, spiritual-based practice that we literally are going to need to figure out one step at a time together. So that's basically what I wanted to share with you sitting under this tree. And I hope that we all can find ways and continue to discuss how we can do this. So again, the idea of the yoga of ecology, the idea of picking up even a piece of garbage with love and compassion instead of with spite and angst and justification for aggression, the ability to hold a space of love and compassion for our enemy, not opposing great totalitarian dictators to then become our own totalitarian dictators, but to really hold a space of love and compassion and to allow ourselves to hold on to nature as truth. And this may be a very valuable and important factor towards the next 5 to 10 years of the ship we're on. So thank you all for being part of listening. And I would just like to address some other aspects that things that people, when I asked if there was anything specific people wanted to speak about before we open to questions. So some people are asking about how to resolve this kind of broadening of knowledge of herbalism and edible plants and actually interacting with the ecosystem. And this also brings in the technological aspect. So what I did was use technology. I would go out and take photographs of every plant I found. I would upload them onto a computer. I would put them in folders, and I continued to do this practice for several years until I started to match plants together, and names would spontaneously come. And I would slowly develop a catalog of awareness of who the plants were in any backyard. And this is a way that technology can actually serve us. And again, technology makes a horrible master, but a great servant. And if we can actually allow the technological capacity that we now have to be integrated in our spiritual quest, this actually helps us to resolve the issue between, again, materialism and spirit, right? The technology can be accessed to get into conference calls so that I'm literally finding myself broadcasting. This is transcending all of TV in one moment. So by going out there and really touching and engaging with the ecosystem directly, I know that nature will take you and teach you, because she is looking for Loraxes. She is looking for those who actually care about what we might call the weeds, the overlooked plants of the world, which will be heightened to the primacy of our direct experience, because dandelions are psychoactive. They change consciousness, especially if they're wild. We haven't really seen that in our chemistry, but it is really true. They speak. They do speak. And it's not like, hey, Joe, how are you doing? I'm a dandelion. But there is an intuitive sense that will develop in you if you make the time to do so. Just the last question before we open it up. So a friend asked, how do I eat in the winter? Well, the same way I eat in the summer, which is I go out and harvest what I can. And it's easy to try to eat a few wild things each day, at least nibbles, even if it's right now some snow. Snow is a wild bean. So try to ingest something from nature that you successfully have identified each day as a way to plug into the Gaia consciousness, a way to plug into the grid. Don't worry about, am I getting my calories from nature directly? That's a very difficult practice. That's a survival practice. That's something of a homesteading practice, which will develop in time once you can make a connection to the Gaian connection or consciousness. Then that will start to develop. But don't get into a dichotomy between, oh my God, I'm eating this, and what should I eat in nature? Because you may make mistakes in your excitement. And those are very careful mistakes to be made, especially with dealing with mushrooms. As I say, no plant or mushroom will kill you, just some of them take you out of body permanently, right? And so that's an effect, but I don't recommend that effect unless you're really interested. So perhaps we can open up for some questions and discuss some of these ideas.
Thank you so much, Dandelion. In order to ask a question, you can press star 6 and to come off mute on your phone. So go ahead, and if you have a question, you can bring your phone off mute and introduce yourself, and we'd love to hear from you. Thanks again.
Can you guys hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool. Yeah, this is Troy. One thing I really enjoyed about what you said, Dandelion, is as far as the aspects of trash. I work at a customer service job at a movie theater, and I deal with trash constantly. And I found it funny because it's like, you know, oftentimes I have to go in the parking lot and clean up trash. And I noticed, like, one time I was doing that with my coworkers, and because there'll be a lot of trash, you know, McDonald's cups and all this and that. And, you know, she was really upset about it. She was, you know, saying that, you know, like kind of portraying this mentality that the people who left this trash are lesser than we are because we don't do this kind of stuff. And, you know, I was thinking to myself, I was like, you know, like, that's also kind of negative to separate yourself from someone who's just, you know, being lazy. And I kind of thought as, you know, as far as what you said, is, you know, not portraying a negative aspect towards it, but more so a positive one. I agree with that wholeheartedly, and I thought that was a great illustration.
Yeah, and just to drive home the point, if I didn't, you know, trash, physical trash is coming from psychic trash. And if we really want to change the garbage throwing, we have to change the inner way of interacting from human to human. And if we want to change that, we have to start with ourselves. It's less exciting, you know, it's less romantic than being able to yell at someone until they won't throw garbage on the ground. But essentially, if I cannot live an example of not making tons and tons of garbage, either psychically or physically, then, you know, what we need right now is solutions, friends, and the whole world is all ears. And through technology, you could broadcast solutions. So we're all ears. We need all the help we can get.
Hello, Dandelion.
Hello.
This is Dave.
Hey, Dave.
You know, you really struck a great chord there when you used the analogy of the garbage, but it obviously applies to all things, that if in our heart we are condemning the others, we're really condemning ourselves because we've allowed a power to that belief that it is a problem in the first place. And I visualized when I was in the Philippines, I was on an island walking up towards a crater lake, and the only thing around us basically was nature. We had some pack animals to help carry our, you know, our excess that we couldn't carry on our own back. But I remember the very first time I saw the sight of what I considered garbage, and it was a wrapper of some sort. And so without really much thought, I just picked it up because it just seemed so out of place. I didn't really think that I was condemning anything, but at the same point, I definitely would if I were back in New Jersey. It caught me off guard, and so I picked it up without thinking about it. And then, quarter mile, another piece, and then somebody saw me as I was putting it in my pocket, and they said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I'm not sure where it came from." And one by one, they all started picking up pieces as they saw it. And I didn't ask them to do it. I didn't blame the people who had come before us. And like you said, if I had blamed that garbage, I would have been creating it. But instead, I just accepted it and went on my way. And other people, in their noticing, they felt some of that same passion and love. So you hit the nail on the head on that. I appreciate you saying that. That it's really, when we go at that intersection, and I used to, where I'd get out of the car and I'd say, "Hey, I think that cigarette butt belongs to you," I'm much more likely to get my head blown off.
And I praise everybody's activism, and I really see that in the last 3, 4, 5 years, we've tried everything. You know, I've tried that. I've definitely been like, "I'm going to teach this person a lesson," right? And yet, who is not transformed yet? Because here's me trying to teach this person a lesson. But if I could just embody a new state of being or referencing to the ecology directly and just learn to shut my mouth about it a little bit, that's when the magic happens, and that's when that person sees you and you really change their life. You know, and so what I've realized is the direct effect that we want to have on people happens without us trying to have the direct effect on people. it's more mysterious than that. It's a way of being, and that way of being is felt by everyone. And so every single human being is psychically perceiving states of being, even though they're in denial that they are. And so when that person observes your sincerity, it just melts their ego. And that's exactly the only thing that seems to make sense. Yes, pick up the garbage and do all that. It's extremely important. And yet it's almost as if picking up garbage, to use just this one frame of reference, there are many ways of practicing an ecologically based mindset. But even by picking up garbage, it's almost as if it's more for us to transform our being, not to for our egos to teach everybody a lesson about what we should do, because we all go home and then, like, drink something in a plastic bottle and throw it in the recycling bin. You know, it's like, it's until we really have a resolved behavioral connection, then we're all in this together, you know.
Hi, Dan. It's Kim.
Hello, Kim.
I hate, you know, that everybody just keeps adding and adding, but I really wanted, I just want to add to that and say that I have noticed that in you, that little shift to not, you know, get down on people and add those little jabs. In a couple of years that I've known you and come to your walks, and I've noticed that in myself and in my yoga classes, that it's not only just me picking up garbage and loving to do it, but there was that fight. So thank you for pointing that out, because I almost do that when I do teach some of my yoga classes. I want everybody to enjoy what I'm saying and grow from what I'm saying, but I do sense a little bit of fight in there too. Like when I see somebody working so hard and their face is gnarled, and I'm like, you're being judgmental on yourself. Don't be judgmental. And I hear these inner talks, and it's exactly what you said. So it transcends the garbage picking and moves its way into the rest of my life and everybody's life. So thank you for pointing that out so that I can adjust even further and grow.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that. And it's a really significant thing to understand, wow, you know, if we really want to make the change, it's not the way we assumed it would be. You know, it's from a different faculty. And, you know, as the Beatles said, I think it was John Lennon, it is being. And the number one thing I want to just remind everyone is, like, you know, then don't have pressure on yourself for manifesting states of being that essentially require practice and community. You know, this is why we're doing this, because no one's perfect at it, right? We need to practice, but if we can lay down the practices and understand even what we're doing, because a lot of the teachings, a lot of the esoteric wisdom that we've developed has not had the culture that we have. So yogis did not have to figure out how to use Google search, and that changes the rules of the game quite tremendously. And so we're updating and upgrading the practices, you know.
It's Kenny here.
Hey, Kenny.
We were able to speak yesterday on the phone, and I came in about 1 minute late, so there were maybe 18 or 19 people under that tree. I came in the middle of the visualization, and I was like, am I in a prayer, or am I in a guided meditation? And it kind of became one and the same thing, and I was, you know, I had phone calls coming in that I had to ignore and tell them, hey, join this call or whatever. And I really felt the visualization very well, even though part of the time my eyes were awake, part of the time I was closed. But I came in right as our bubble of awareness was getting to the outer rim of our galaxy. After she was talking about the sun and everything. Our sun being a stargate, you know, a gate where life comes through and rains down on our universe, which is very cool. As I've passed through the gelatinous place into the portal and then into this new realm and saw these, you know, fun, you know, these creatures and the center of, you know, being in life in this other world, and then we eventually got to the tree where we all were. And I would just like to say that I'll probably be visiting that place more often now that I've been taken to it. And I, you know, I will maybe see some of you there. You know, as I use my imagination, I will come to that clearing and see that tree, and I think maybe there's bonfire there too. And our faces are illuminated by the glow. And I would like to hang out in that place in my own meditative time, and you know, go there and be there, and maybe take other people that I know there as well.
Thank you so much for that feedback, Kenny. This is Emma Kett. In our guided visualization, this is the same guided meditation that we do every time we have any event for the Sphinx Mystery School. And the temple that we passed by is usually where we meet, and we didn't really go inside of the temple this time. We're sitting under the tree that's next to the temple. But you are welcome to come visit here anytime that you like. We've created this space through our mystery school to visit in meditation and in guided visualization as a community space where we can gather. And there are many, many, many people who have come here before, and I have a feeling that there will be many more in the future. So feel free to come and participate. There actually is a fire burning in our temple that's been burning since winter solstice, and you're welcome to come inside of the temple as well and check it out there, and to join us in our other mystery school events where we begin with this same meditation. And I wanted to mention in the beginning of our meditation, when we traveled out in our orb of awareness, that was based on the Theta Healing Method, which it was developed by Vianna Steibel. And it helps us access the Theta Brainwave State, which is the state that we go to when we're just waking up or about to fall asleep. It's different than a hypnotic or deep beta meditation. It's a very active space, a mental space to be in. So we like to also open up our calls with that as well to kind of get us all in the same brainwave state. So really appreciate your feedback, and feel free to stay in tune with us either in your own personal meditations, or if you'd like to join our future events, you can stay linked with us online through Facebook or on our website, sphinxmysteryschool.com. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I was able to have my eyes open and be there simultaneously because I was eating a mango, or I was, you know, doing this or that. I was just like, wow, I can't believe I'm able to see this, all this stuff pop up. I've got like two windows open in my head, one of my imagination and one of my visual world at the same time, and that's kind of rare.
Yeah, it is rare, and the intention for going into the meditation in the beginning of our councils is so that even if we are eating a mango or driving a car, or we're all in our own individual worlds in the physical world, that we can find common ground in the non-physical world, in the spirit world, to gather together. So it's a great technique for this type of work. So that even if we are doing other things, we're all still attuning in the same space. So that's really cool that even with your eyes open, you can still tap in. So thank you.
Thank you.
I was going to... Oh, I'm sorry. It's Kim again. I was going to mention something earlier about that meditation, but I totally forgot. I got engrossed in the conversation. I've never gone to a pink gelatinous gate. That is the first time I've ever heard of that. And I said, okay, let's just go with this. And all of a sudden, I just, for lack of a better word, I just zenned out. I hit that beautiful state, and it clicked immediately. And I went, wow, maybe I'll be going through the gelatinous gate again, because it was so beautiful. Nothing could get me out. None of my thoughts were grabbing my attention. It was just, boom, very interesting.
Yes, I think jelly-like substance in the Theta meditation is a really awesome state to be in, and it reminds me of like the amniotic fluid almost. And so what we're doing when we're going further and further and further out, and we reach that that they call it the seventh plane of consciousness. We're actually coming full circle back into our awareness here. So we go far, far, far out to the very, very, very edge, and then we're kind of reborn back into our awareness here. And part of why I felt it was important to bring this meditation into our call today and the subject and what Dandelion has gone over is to recognize, like Dandelion, you touched in your talk, and I really love that about, you know, the elements in the soil all originating from these huge supernova gas giants, and the connection that to the earth that's important, but also recognizing that as far out as we can go, this is all aspects of nature as well that we're connected to. So, yeah, if you want more information on Theta Healing or the meditation, I can share some links in our Facebook event about Theta Healing Meditation. There's some guided meditations online available, and you guys know the map now, so you can go there anytime. It's an amazing place to go to when you're working with belief systems and outdated belief systems that we're wishing to clear and replace with a new perspective. So I felt that was also fitting for what we were going to go over today, that if we're in that space, we're really open to clearing out any outdated belief systems and replacing that with creator's perspective. So thank you, guys. Thank you.
Hey, Dan, it's me, Troy, again.
Hello.
A question I wanted to ask you, and it's something that I kind of brought up to you via Facebook Messenger not too long ago. You know, as I mentioned previously, I work at a movie theater, and you know, I'm young. I'm 21 years old. But it's like I've been finding myself in a kind of a, you know, struggle between like what I explained in the message I sent you is that, you know, it's like I have this one part of me that, you know, I love primitive living skills. I love learning about plants. I love just the outdoors and all that it provides and offers. But at the same time, it's like there's another side to me that is kind of scared to really kind of delve into that outdoorsy side of me. You know, this safe side that I'm, I guess you could say, currently residing in right now is, you know, working full-time at the movie theater, you know, going to school and, you know, just kind of, and not really paying much focus to, you know, going into the woods more. I haven't been into the woods in a good while, and it's like I feel it kind of just draining me. You know, it's like I'm not as happy as I know I could be, and you know, I just kind of, I wanted to get your input on as far as should I just kind of take the, you know, big risk and really just immerse myself in primitive living and nature and really just focus on that and grow from it. Or should I, you know, kind of play it safe for a while and then maybe, you know, a couple of years from now or something like that. I don't know. I just wanted to get your input on that.
Yeah, well, it's a very good quest and question is to, you know, essentially it is back to the same duality between materialism and spirit or inside and outside, finding meditative practice time versus, hey, your whole life is meditation. This is a really difficult balance. And so what I sort of propose is that we have to find our underlying desire. And so if my underlying desire is to serve the awakening of the planet, then all tools become part of that intention. Even in the movie theater, I'm sweeping the floor, and yet some transformation is occurring through my own being, through my patience, through what I'm thinking, through how I'm smiling at people. So, you know, the best of meditation is when we're finding the ability to glimpse our meditation in our life. Now, that's a very difficult, it can potentially be very difficult, and it should not be pretentious. It should not be in a place of like, oh, well, my life is meditation. I don't need to go into nature or whatever. So if you feel called to go into nature, instead of making it too extreme, right, of I need to either completely devote my life to primitive living skills or I need to, you know, work a shitty job that I hate, can we somehow invoke the idea that actually everything is training us for the next level of awakening to our purpose? And the real deep trust that actually everything is giving me, working at the movie theater is developing communicative and people skills and the ability to smile even if people are frowning and being rude. That's a tremendous practice. And then what we need to realize and recognize is that we have a finitude of energy to go into the matrix and work it. And so then we need to know when to step back, when to burn some sage, when to take a hot bath, when to go in the forest. And both of those practices are needed, and yet we don't need to have one or the other, and we don't need to jump from the extremes. So what I propose is sort of the techno-paleolithic return sort, is that we're not going to suddenly transcend the technology world or the physical plane necessarily, but we can actually work the physical plane as a part of a playground or a part of our spiritual awakening. So can we seek to non-dualize those things? And if you really have in your heart the desire to serve Gaia or serve the awakening of humanity, that source will take you over and tell you when the next step is there to quit the job and transcend that into something else. And it should be a very smooth and gradual process. And always with the remembrance that I'm here to serve consciousness. I'm here to serve humanity. This is not about the finite details that my mind might get caught in. This is about service to the greater good. And then everything becomes the work, you know, the spiritual work.
Well, thank you very much, Dan. I really appreciate that.
I'd like to say, this is Kenny, you know, you can reach a lot of people wherever you are. So if you were to just, you know, drop it all and hollow, you know, live in the trunk of a tree, I mean, I'm sure that would be great, but at the same time, you could meet a lot of people and start a lot of conversations at your community college or at your college or start, you know, start your own group. Bring those other people, you know, that are here for what Dan mentioned, are here for what you're here for and are here for what I'm here for. As this paradigm change, you'll be able to, you know, gradually, if not instantly, when you get your mind right, bring them into the fold and bring yourself and start to combine all of our powers and combine all of our intention together. And you may, you know, there's, like Dan mentioned, and like all of us know, like there's so many people willing, there's so many people who are like looking for something, but they don't know what it is. There's, you know, we need new ways of living. And if you're going to, you might be that one person that, you know, changes your whole community. And if you're in that community, then you can change it, you know, and you can have a very positive influence on all your classmates and all your workmates by using your mouth and using your example.
Yeah, or your smile or calmness amidst tragedy. All these things really affect everything so deeply. If we can only... I know that I just drank some very potent medicine in the Amazon, and when I did, I was floored by the realization of how significant everything is. And truly, we cannot conceive of the significance of everything, or else it would be hard to do anything. And so, you know, the hope and the prayer to hold on to is just, you know, I hope that I don't screw it up worse, and just let me be of service to anything and to anyone. And if we really can maintain that help, and whether it's helping the grandma across the street
or whether it's smiling at some, like, kid who won't take their iPhone headphones off. All of that really, really affects everything. And over 10 years or 20 years or 50 years makes a huge difference. So it's like, it's knowing the balance between when to do a thing and when not to. And this is sort of how we bring the spiritual practice into the matrix of reality or life, is that sometimes we feel compelled to touch or reach out to someone in a way that's very awkward, and yet, you know, sink or swim. Here we go.
Yeah.
This is Emma. I'd love to respond to this question as well. I think that when we realize that we are always in nature, no matter how developed an area might be, and that we are animals, we are also pack animals. We are tribal animals. So the idea of connecting with others and community, with joining together with one another and doing this service work with the earth is part of our natural instinct. And so that's a huge part of shifting our awareness, is becoming aware of nature wherever we are. So, like, I right now I live up in the Sierra Nevada mountains, way up in the mountains, and I'm surrounded by forest and rivers and animals and things. And recently I went to the city of Los Angeles, and it was pretty jarring in the environment, feeling like I was disconnected from nature. And when we first got there, we were like, let's go to nature, you know, let's go to nature. And it wasn't until there was a huge windstorm one night, and we were looking out the windows, and I noticed all the palm trees swaying in the wind, and realized that beneath the concrete, there's a saying in Europe, a graffiti slogan that in Spanish translates to, in English, to beneath the cobblestones is the beach. And it's this idea that beneath the pavement is still the living earth. And so something that really helps me when I'm feeling disconnected, if I'm in a city, I'm walking around, is to pay attention to the land spirits that still exist there. Noticing the plants, noticing the trees, saying hello to them and thanking them for being there. And it's amazing how much the land spirits will sort of light up and become activated just through our conscious awareness of them being there. So that dandelion that's bursting through the cracks of the pavements, you know, honoring and recognizing its medicine as we walk through the city. And this can be a really simple way to tune ourselves back in. And also the elementals, the air, the fire, the sun, the water, the earth, the soil itself. There really is nowhere we can go on this planet or beyond that is not in nature. And so when we shift our perception to recognize that, the earth responds to that for us. And when we walk in that way, we are embodying that, and it helps others to become inspired to do the same. So we don't even have to tell anybody what to do. It's just through our awareness and the vibration that we're holding of our recognition and our gratitude for the nature spirits that are present all the time that can really assist in the paradigm shift. So I wanted to share that as well. Thanks.
Yeah. And in that transitional nature, in the time being before you can fully realize that, recognize the finitude of your tolerance and act in accordance with that. So don't blast yourself, you know, hard and then react aggressively. Get out, breathe in, like, that's all okay, you know, like, it's to make 5 minutes a day to do your sadhana or your meditation or your get out of the city or going into the woods, really honor that as well. And this is the sort of seeming duality of the practice. Yes, find nature everywhere, and also know when you need to get out of the environment, when you've had enough, when you've chewed enough food and you need digestive time. This is extremely important, you know.
Thank you. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
No, go ahead.
Emma, you actually brought something full circle, because
the forest is a physical state we might locate on a map, but the forest is also the state of mind. And while it's winter, I have just a few houseplants in my bedroom, but they are my forest when the snow is outside, and I can wake up, and just recently one of them set out its first flowers, and in my, you know, my dream state of waking up in the morning, I looked and I was there in the forest in my head just by seeing that pink color that was not there the day before. And that brought me in such a state of bliss, realizing that I can have nature wherever I am.
That's a very, very good point. Troy, I also wanted to interject and also add on to what Kenny was saying when he was mentioning, you know, going out into your local college or whatever. But realize where you're at. And just like Dan was saying, we're never going to know all the meanings for everything. But you're in a movie theater, dude. You are seeing so many people come in and out, and I personally feel that there's a reason why you're there, and there's a reason why you're also on this phone call. So maybe not feeling so horribly about seeing the trash around you and seeing all these people that you wish, you know, things would change, and you don't have to jump full speed into the freezing cold ocean and be a survivalist, because I think it was Alan Watts that mentioned the Tibetan monks, they're not really helping anybody if they're all hiding themselves away in a mountain somewhere and then getting their own inspiration there and not sharing it with the rest of the world. It's once they find it, they come down and they bring it to other people, and they put themselves in the situations where it is difficult to keep that presence of mind. And, you know, that's part of the practice. But, dude, you're in a movie theater. You don't need to go out to, you know, colleges. And don't force it. Just little steps at a time. Follow your heart. And smile at the kid with the headphones, like Dan said. You know, little things at a time. But I think you're in the movie theater for a reason. So just honor that in some regard. I hope that helps.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah.
Hey, Peace. This is Zinaru. I also would like to add, just in this topic of conversation, it's really important that we be nature. We are nature. So wherever we're at, to be nature, if we're in the city, like my experience is in like Los Angeles or New York, you know, what is nature? Nature's yielding. Nature's peaceful. But nature can also be really aggressive. Nature can also be very defensive. Nature can also be very harsh. Nature can also be very unyielding. And so to be that nature and know when to balance that nature, in my experience, is that we have to tune into our supernatural self, that part of ourselves, that spirit that's beyond nature. Because as humanity, we've been given this stewardship, and not even say given, but our part in this ecology of the earth is as stewards of this. We have this supernatural ability that other animals don't have. And it's very important for us to honor and direct that in its proper place. Because with the things that we can do in our daily life, the earth is in need of defense, and we as humanity are a defense of nature. We're a defense mechanism of nature. And that's where we have to spread the knowledge. We have to spread the word. We have to take steps in that. So that's just what I would like to add, that to be nature and also part of our nature is supernatural because of what we're able to create, invent, and extract and give back to nature. So we're very, very, we're beyond important to the survival of this planet and to the survival of the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, this entire world. We are beyond important for that. We are like the literal salvation for that as humanity. And it's something that requires us to tune in. It's George Bertelstein taught me that it's the ego of the world that tells us we're not great. It's the ego of the world that, oh, you're just a man or you're just a woman. You're not really all that important. That's the ego of the world. But Great Spirit is like, yo, you are so important. You are the key ingredient to planet Earth life. I experience Earth through you. So it's very important that we take that nobility back. We take that responsibility back. We take that stewardship back in a very profound and strong way, like a mountain, like a giant boulder we have to root into that being and knowing our true power and nature as humans being on this planet. So thank you all for bringing up this topic of discussion and participating. I'll pass the talking stick. Peace.
Okay, that's an excellent point. And just quickly, just to say, I've seen so many people get on that guilt trip of, oh no, look what we've done to the earth. We've done this. We don't have a right to live. We don't have a right to be here. And I just want to reach out and slap them in the face and be like, listen, it's our right to help this. It's our right. Stop getting on that guilt trip. Let it go. You're part of this. You're part of it.
Well, I would just like to add to that and just to remind everyone that we are significant but no more or no less significant than everything else on the ecosystem, and that in some way Gaia manifested a conscious sentience. We're the first really ones to contemplate the meaning of meaning versus just the consciousness itself. And so as stewards or caretakers, I invite everyone to really churn within their own being of what that even means, and how do we include our technological and behavioral aspects into what caretaking the ecosystem may be like. So we are a significant aspect. We are not necessarily a higher aspect. We are a significant aspect. And the question is, what is nature? And obviously, we don't mean trees and plants and stuff. We mean a grid of awareness and a grid of consciousness that is like the deepest level of what's inside of our intuition. And so we must be careful to use our minds to determine the ethics of how to caretake with nature and not make it a mental thing, but make it a real, true, instinctual path of understanding our role in the ecosystem.
Again, and everybody, it's Dave again. Going back to your talk about our effectiveness as activists, I became aware after going through a march that the march was really for me. Yes, it was to educate other people, but to the passerbys, just seeing some people in the street with some signs didn't really necessarily jog or jive the consciousness. And perhaps even more damaging is that it could provide that frustration. Again, it's like picking up the garbage. Am I doing it for me? Am I doing it for the planet? Or am I just doing it because I should be doing it, or I feel good in doing it? But if I'm condemning a corporation, but I'm not providing an outlet, I'm just creating frustration that is left unvented. It would be so much better to provide solutions. So something that I had proposed to Teresa Lamb was, for the next march, if there's going to be another march, wouldn't it be better to have an Earth Day with solar panels and green drinks and stainless steel containers and music with words, but have an outlet, have the resources of what you can do instead of stomping your feet and saying this is no good. Find, these are the things you can do. You can invest your time, your money in things that are in harmony with the Earth. And that seems so much more relieving when I think of it that way, as these are the solutions rather than condemning the problem.
That's an
excellent point.
Go for it.
Oh, I was going to say it reminded me of the South Park episode. Well, they were a bunch of hippies, and yeah, we're going to change the world. But you guys never do anything.
Well, you know, I find it's really important for us to realize that we're one big team, and there are many necessities at this time, you know. And so if we can also find a way to harmonize as one global mind,
saying, okay, well, some of us need to be signing petitions, and some of us need to be kind of churning up that unsettled energy, and some of us only can harp on the problems, and some of us have some solutions. And within that, I think a great humbleness comes because, you know, when we really observe, you know, these stainless steel water bottles or solar panels really going to make a difference? No. What will make the difference is a solution based of heartfelt perception, not things. But of course, a materialist culture would get confused in thinking that if we just change the materials, we will change the consciousness. But it doesn't work that way. And yet, it's all important. These are all important transitional steps. However, the transition is an internal transition. It's a transition of respect and caretaking and care and the ability to manifest a more caring attitude through the practices. And we have to be careful that it doesn't turn into just some green corporatism where we're switching natural gas for solar panels that are made with plastic in China getting shipped, and now we're green on solar panels. There is a deeper fundamental level I see, which is that if people and if we can wake up to realizing that we are nature, then suddenly we would feel the consequences of our behaviors and therefore change from our own ethical standpoint versus another externalized law, which hasn't gotten us anywhere. You know?
Good point. I'm glad I'm not the only one that sees that.
I have a friend who says our problems are our projects, and that the problem is oftentimes the solution, like S-O-U-L, solution. And so looking at the problems that we're facing today on the earth as projects, and I love what you said, Dandelion, around, you know, that it's not so much as a material or physical solution as much as a shift in our awareness first, and thus the byproduct being the physical world made manifest in a new way. So I think there's many, many of us who feel the same way and are finding words to express that and action to express that. And so the more that we counsel together and gather together asking artful questions, it allows for those problems to become more of a project. So.
Hear, hear.
So are there any other questions or comments? We're probably going to close here pretty soon. So if anyone has anything they'd like to share, now would be a good time.
I have a quick... Oh, go ahead.
I'm just wondering the name of the guided meditation woman from the Sphinx Mystery School.
That's me. My name's Emma Kett. Emma Kett Uru. You can find me on Facebook through the event invite. And you can also check out our website for the Mystery School at www.sphinxmysteryschool.com. We have recordings of our previous councils, and we're going to be posting the recording for this event as well in the next few days. And we hold a dream council every Sunday where we gather just like this. We have a guided meditation, we go through the forest to our temple, and then we discuss our dreams and interpret them for one another. So you're all welcome to come participate in that as well.
Thanks a lot.
Hey, Dan, this is Troy. I had a quick question for you.
Sure.
It's a little, I guess, slightly off topic. But as far as your dreadlocks, I know me personally, I've always loved the look of dreadlocks, and I've always thought they were so cool. And then, you know,
a year ago, I did a bunch of research on it and just read about people's experiences and all that. And so far, you know, I'm only a month into like my free form kind of method, but I was curious as to how your dreads are, and I guess maybe like a particular reason why you grew them out.
Well, for me, it's just a matter of allowing myself to be. And what I've found is that for my own practice, a razor is just not part of my daily practice. So just like I wouldn't really mow my lawn if I had an idea of the lawn, I don't really cut my hair. And that gives me the freed-up ability to not contemplate how I look for the day, which is really enjoyable. So my hair has locked basically as a result of just allowing it to be. I didn't go for a dreadlock hairstyle or something like that. I do find that there are many traditions. Everybody knows the Rastafarian tradition, but there is also a connection between Haile Selassie and the yogic traditions in India. And basically what the locks of hair do is they store energy. And as I often recommend to people who ask me about this, you know, it's an extra responsibility because you're getting a larger level of antenna. And some of that really ties us into past. So we have to keep cleaning the energy off of our being if we're going to have dreadlocks down to our butt, because it's a whole different experience going into, a grocery store or something. Those antennas actually perceive and pick up a lot more. So that's sort of it in a nutshell.
And
awesome.
I find that funny that you said that, because the Native Americans, I saw a piece when they went to war in the Vietnam War and everybody had to shave their head. A lot of the Native Americans were being used for their ability to trap. And once they cut their hair off, they lost their ability to some extent.
Yeah, it's also in Kenya during a huge uprising revolutionary time. The people who were part of the activists in the community started to grow their hair into dreadlocks as a statement of returning back to the tribal and natural ways of living, and almost as a form of rebellion. So it's interesting to consider that as well, as sort of it's a statement that we make unconsciously for others. Some people do grow them consciously to be seen this way, but when we naturally begin to lock up, we can sometimes be seen as rebels or seen, but also as a desire to return to nature. So.
Go for it.
Oh.
Sorry.
I just wanted to make a quick comment to everyone who's listening. This is Troy speaking. I wanted to thank everyone, you know, for you gave me some great input on this question / struggle that I've been having, and I really appreciate it, and I love all you guys, even though I've never met you in person. I love you.
Love you.
I'm getting all gooey inside, like the pink gelatinous mask.
This is the undeniable power of the human spirit that transcends all ego battles. If we can hold love in our heart, the ego battling would eventually settle. And this is really the task at hand. So this is why we're developing community. We're holding the network of a large amount of on-work material. So there's a lot more weight to it. There's a lot more tangibility because less people are holding the weight of transformation. So in some essence, the spiritual world got completely mucked up through the inability to work on the resonant karma that gets stuck there.
So now we're kind of cleaning it and clearing it for everybody and working on how that brings resentment and clearing out all the resentment too so that we can be a better channel of that. So I thank everyone for doing whatever work you're doing in the world, as I know you all are, and I really appreciate the time to be able to speak and flow with you all. It's great to hear everybody's sharing and feedback, and I look forward to doing more of this with the Mystery School, as well as Return to Nature. And if anybody would like to be in touch, there's obviously my website is returntonature.us, or I have a Facebook page called Return to Nature, also a YouTube channel called Return to Nature Skills. So please be in touch, and lots of workshops and lots of classes. And I really love the idea that we can digitally come together in somewhat astral spaces and really hold counsel that was once physically not possible, and now it is. So ha ha ha. Even again. Thank you, everyone. Many blessings.
Thank you so much, Dandelion, for being here and being part of our Mystery School and now being part of our lineage. And you're welcome back anytime, and just really appreciate you coming through this forum and sharing your wisdom, and we look forward to connecting in the future. We found you online, so I really, one of the things that really spoke to me was your ability to bridge the earth wisdom and the work you're doing in the world through technology. And oftentimes it's sort of like we do have this idea that we have to check out of the networks in order to be connected with nature. So everything that you post is so inspiring to so many people, including myself and our Mystery School. So we thank you from the center of our heart for being present with us today. And thanks to everyone who joined the call and participated. Thank you for sharing your voices. And for those of you that are silent, thank you for your presence and your deep listening. We really appreciate everyone. We are all part of the lineage of this Mystery School now, so we appreciate you. And to close, I'd like to bring our awareness back to the tree in which we are sitting under right now together in the space, and to notice our heartbeats again and to feel our hearts beating and to connect our hearts with one another, to feel the grid that we've created on the planet today. And all of the information that has been shared in this council today, just with our breath and our awareness, allowing that to settle into our bodies. So we don't have to cognitively remember everything right now. We've stored this information deep in our DNA and in our hearts. And we just ask that the information that serves our highest and best and resonates with us come through at just the right time when